Christ, shalom, most high in Christ, bless everybody. Happy New Moon Sabbath to the 12 tribes of Israel. I am Brother Raphael, and to my right,
Brother Benaniah.
Today's topic, or tonight's topic rather, as we segue into the new moon, it's going to be called Alms Versus Tithe. Alms Versus Tithe. You know, that's one of the most controversial topics, I would just say, in religion. I said that way. I said, even with Christianity, because one thing about it, y'all, as we were coming up in the church per se, we're going to show you an article. And one thing about it, y'all, is for some odd reason, our people do not read the scriptures, don't understand what tithing is about, what it was, how it was implemented. About alms, and we're going to deal with it briefly. We're not going to be too long today, or tonight rather. Want everybody to enjoy themselves for the new moon. But, we're going to talk about it a little bit, discuss it, and show you, how it translates even to today. Because one thing we have to keep in mind, y'all, is the so-called blacks and the so-called Hispanics, Native Americans, we are the biblical Israelites. We are the people of the book. We are the children of the slaves. We are the people who the Lord loves. We are the people who we're going to discuss about the law. And here's a key element. When you look at the commandments in its entirety, right, you look at how they tell you in Christianity, laws are done away with. Laws are done away with, right? Now, once we read about the tithe, we're going to go over the tithe and find out who's the tithe for. What was it about? Was it really about money? How often should you tithe? All these things that our people need to understand, because when we were in Christianity, they just played Malachi 3:8, put the music on to get your emotions flowing, and just get you all, lathered up to take your money. And one thing about it, y'all, they've been doing this for quite some time. And we're going to do tonight, and we're going to segue, look into the scriptures, talk about it, show you how it translates today, because our people need to know what they're doing. Why are you giving alms? What is alms about? What is tithing about? Okay, and how was it implemented, and who is it for? And that's one of the things we're going to discuss today and just go over it briefly. I'm going to talk about how Christ actually showed us in the New Testament. And we're going to discuss, was alms really dealing with the New Testament as well? Okay, but anyway, some of y'all may be new. You might not understand that we do teach that you have to keep commandments and in faith of Christ. You just can't say you have Christ and no laws, and laws and no Christ. They have to be coupled together. Let's start off with the book of Isaiah, chapter 8 and verse 20, and I want Joshua, chapter 1, verse 8, brother.
Shalom. Happy New Moon Sabbath. Isaiah chapter 8 verse 20.
Go ahead, brother.
To the law.
To the law. So some of y'all might not understand that we have the King James Version 1611 edition with the Apocrypha. We have that Bible. The whole Bible is the law from Genesis all the way to Revelation. The 1611 King James Version Bible is the most accurate Bible out there. That's why we use it, because there's a different spirit upon that Bible. From there, Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, brother, to prove our point. Okay, go ahead.
Joshua chapter 1, verse 8.
Go ahead.
This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth.
This whole Bible, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth. Go ahead, read.
But thou shalt meditate therein day and night.
You should meditate, study, and apply day and night. Go ahead, brother.
That thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein.
Go ahead.
For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, mm-hmm. and then thou shalt have good success.
Because that is a true prosperity doctrine. We're going to touch on that. Because the prosperity doctrine is the real reason why these so-called pastors and priests, whatever they may call themselves, they are actually using this Bible to extort money from people. We're going to deal with that. Prosperity, right? So let's go back to the book of Isaiah, chapter 8 and verse 20. And I want Revelation, chapter 19, verse 10, brother, because precept must be upon precept. That's why we jump from book to book, brothers and sisters. Go ahead, brother, read.
Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20.
Go ahead.
To the law, mm-hmm. and to the testimony.
And the testimony. Let's find what the testimony is according to the Bible, the Revelation. Chapter 19 and verse 10. Declare that point up, brother. Go ahead.
Revelation chapter 19, verse 10.
Uh-huh.
And I fell at his feet to worship him.
Go ahead, brother.
And he said unto me, see thou do it not.
Now the angel had to stop John. He said, "See thou do it not, because that John bowed down to the angel, he would have been in the midst of idolatry. See thou do it not." Go ahead, read, brother.
"I am thy fellow servant."
We are the fellow servants of the Most High in Christ. We serve the Most High first, and we serve our fellow Israelite brother and sister. Go ahead, read.
"And of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus."
The testimony of the Christ, the Messiah. Some of y'all may say Yahweh Shai, but we do know he is the Son of the Most High. Go ahead, read.
"Worship God."
Worship the Most High. There's no other power above the Most High God of Israel. No Allah, no white man Jesus, no Krishna. None of that nonsense. Go ahead, read.
"For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy."
Because if you have this, you have to have the spirit of Christ on you. If you don't have the spirit of Christ on y'all, brothers and sisters, you will not understand this Bible in its entirety. You'll be lost in the sauce. Reading this Bible with no comprehension, okay? From there, back to the book of Isaiah, chapter 8, verse 20, and I want Proverbs, chapter 6, and verse 23.
Isaiah, chapter 8, verse 20.
Go ahead.
"To the law and to the testimony."
Go ahead.
"If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them."
Because of your spiritual leader or your pastor, if they don't speak precept upon precept, as the Bible is written, the Bible says there is no light in them. Proverbs, chapter 6, and verse 23.
Proverbs chapter 6, verse 23.
Go ahead, brother.
"For the commandment is a lamp."
Go ahead.
"And the law is light."
And the laws in Christ, brothers and sisters, are supposed to help illuminate you. It's supposed to help you navigate through darkness, which is sin. And the example would be, it's supposed to correct you for being a sinner transgressor. If I'm a person left to steal and I love the $5 discount, I'm supposed to take the commandment to a higher level, measure them with Christ, and recognize Christ was not a thief. Okay? Go ahead, read.
"And reproofs of instruction are the way of life."
Because reproof is correction. Like I just gave you an example. If you're a sinner, a transgressor of the law, you need to take the law to a higher level through Christ, recognize that Christ was a sinner, you follow Christ as the Bible is written. Now, what we're going to start the class off with pastors and find out what their income is, and we're going to discuss it, because that's a very troubling thing for me. Personally, I'm pretty sure other brothers and sisters can actually attest for that. Where that was in Christianity, I call it Christian insanity, because it's insane to not read the scriptures for yourself and not recognize about how they're utilizing scriptures. And we're gonna show you something. And we're gonna go right to the scriptures and show you how it was implemented. So let's get the article. Let's check it out. Yeah, pull the one you get. I like the one you pulled up. Yeah, pull that one up. The one you pulled up earlier. Yeah. Yeah. Right, exactly. Because I want to show the income. Because, see, we're going to show y'all if this is a bit excessive. Because one thing, I'm going to just say this to y'all, okay? When you recognize alms, right? And let's deal with the tithe. We're going to deal with the tithe. It's nothing wrong with full-time ministry. It's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes things get a little excessive. Because you got to ask yourself a question. Do you need 3 and 4 planes? Do you need big mansions? I mean, that stuff is really, when you think about it, those things are really excessive. You know what I'm saying? When you really think about it. Because full-time ministry, you can have a nice house. You can have a beautiful home. You can have a nice car. Nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with the fruits of your labor. But we're going to find out if it's a little bit excessive. Let's go right to it. Look at the article. Let's check it out. You want to read?
All right. Kenneth Copeland. The richest pastor in the world presently is Kenneth Copeland, who was born in December 1936. He is the owner and founder of Kenneth Copeland Ministries, located in Tarrant County, Texas. He is the richest pastor in the world, 2023.
Look at the bottom.
All right. He is said to be a musician, author, public speaker, and an owner of 3 private jets, and His net worth is estimated to be about $300 million.
That's Kenneth Copeland right there. Okay. Give me another one of those pastors. Give me another one. Pull another one up. Matter of fact, let's get one of our people, the one of the most known ones. Just put up T.D. Jakes up there. Put him up there. Thomas Dexter Jakes. Put him up there. Just put his picture up there. And the reason why I'm saying that is because years ago, when Eldo's eyes at the time, when he was here, we went down to the Richmond Coliseum. You remember that?
Yeah.
And they had a concert with T.D. Jakes. And when the people came out of the concert, we asked them questions. Just to ask, what did y'all learn at the concert? Now, the brother, he was there talking to us. The men, supposed to talk to men. His wife comes in. That's how I know Christianity is all, because the wife coming in, usurping her authority, you know, basically bossing, move him out the way. She saw, oh, it's the issues of blood. Okay. What about the issues of blood? Since you're talking, miss, because that's kind of out of order. You usurping your husband. Nah, you're supposed to not do that. That's disrespectful. But that's how they run their marriage. So be it. So anyway, we asked, okay, miss, since you want to talk to us, all right, what about it? Explain it. What scripture? Now, mind you, we're not disrespecting nobody. We're just talking. The whole point I'm making with this, y'all, is this. You can show it. If you don't know why you're doing something, then shame on you. Okay? We will not tell you to do something and not show you why you're doing something. Because when you think about it for a minute, you at a concert, and I'm pretty sure them tickets weren't cheap. I promise you that. Matter of fact, I spoke to another sister years ago. She told me, because it was, I think it was St. Paul's Baptist Church out here in Richmond. She said that T.D. Jakes told their congregation that if they did not give him $15,000, he would not show up. I said, wow. I said, that really Christ-like? Because I don't recall Christ telling the multitude, unless you give me 15,000 shekels, I will not give you the gospel. That's what I'm, you know, go ahead, brother. You got something to say?
No.
Because it blew my mind. I was like, wait a minute. This, you know, can we just line it up with the scriptures? I'm not saying that, you know, you can't, you know, deal with your, you know, whatever leaders you have, whatever. I mean, all praise, whatever you want to do. But the fact of the matter is for that man to say, if that's true, to put a price tag like that on the gospel and to do that to people, to put that kind of pressure on someone, to me, I don't think that's not Christ-like. We're gonna go over the scriptures. Just bear with us. We're gonna hit the scriptures. I'm gonna hit the famous scripture they love to hit in church. Give me Malachi chapter 3 and verse 8. Let's get some understanding. Joel's thing, yeah. Yeah, him too. All of them. See, we're gonna deal with it, y'all, because it's really sad that when someone does this to people, it puts a burden on someone. And you shouldn't have to do that to someone. We're going to show you how it really supposed to be done and how it was supposed to be done back in ancient times and how does it translate today. Okay? So Malachi, let's go to Malachi. I want you to start it. Go to verse 3. No, chapter 3, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. And verse 8. Let's go to the famous scripture that they pulled in church. They love to pull. They play the music.
Verse 8.
Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Malachi chapter 3, verse 8.
Go ahead.
Will a man rob God?
Stop right there. Will a man rob God? So now they're already playing on your emotions already. Wow, I don't want to rob God. You know, I don't want to rob the Most High. You know, will a man rob God? Let's use common sense here. The Most High owns everything. You can't rob the Most High. Okay? I'm just saying that to show you, let's deal with simplicity right now. You can't rob the Most High because he owns everything, right? Start with that first. Read.
Yet ye have robbed me.
Uh-huh.
But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?
Go ahead, brother.
In tithes and offerings.
In tithes and offerings. In tithes and offering. Okay, hold that. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 14 and verse 22. Let's find out about the tithe. Let's find out about it. Because you know something? They'll say that to you, and oh, would a man rob God? And they will play on your emotions because you know, let's just be honest. You're sincere. You don't know no better. You just going by what the pastor tell you, and that's bad because you got to read the Bible for yourself. But you just listening to the pastor. You're trusting in his judgment. And you say, okay, I don't want to rob God. Right? So, let's go right to it, brother. Go ahead.
Deuteronomy 14:22.
Oh, there we go. Now, keep in mind now, Deuteronomy is a law. Deuteronomy is second law. It's the first five books, right? So when we look at tithe, let's find out if it's a law. Because keep in mind now, they tell you in Christianity that laws are done away with, right? Deuteronomy means second law in the Greek. Second law in the Greek. So it's the fifth book of the Bible, right? So it's in the law, right? In the testimony, right? Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 14 and verse 22.
Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 22.
Go ahead, brother.
Thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed.
So now you should truly tithe all the increase of thy seed. What people have to understand about Israel, our nation, the primary source of income was agriculture. We were farmers. That's why if you notice when Christ gave parables, the mustard seed. Mm-hmm. And you know, the parable of the sower,
grapevine,
the vine, the olive tree. He always gave those parables because we can relate because we were farmers, we were husbandmen.
Right.
Okay, so that's why he says, thou shalt tithe all the increase of thy seed. Right? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
That the field bring it forth year by year.
That the field bring forth year by year. So now that shows you're dealing with crops, right? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 23.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God,
mm-hmm,
in the place which he shall choose,
uh-huh,
to place his name there.
Now, what is the place where he should choose from there? Give me the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 6 and verse 6. What place shall he choose? Okay? Because now we're going to show you what place did he choose, because we're dealing with tithe, right? We're dealing with tithe right now, right? You should truly tithe all the increase of your land, right? Because just during the time when, in the ancient times, when we were farmers, we had agriculture back then. That was our means of, we called commerce back then, right? So go ahead on.
Second Chronicles chapter 6, verse 6.
Go ahead.
But I have chosen Jerusalem.
He chose who?
Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
That my name might be there.
So now we understand that Jerusalem is the place where the Most High has chosen. Go back to Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23. Go ahead, brother.
Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23.
Go ahead.
And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God,
mm-hmm,
in the place which he shall choose,
uh-huh,
to place his name there.
You understand that's just Jerusalem. Go ahead, read.
The tithe of thy corn.
Go ahead.
Of thy wine.
Go ahead.
And of thine oil.
Go ahead.
And the firstlings of thy herd.
Go ahead.
And of thy flocks.
Mm.
That thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God, mm-hmm, always.
So now now we understand that we're dealing with our flocks. We're dealing with the increase of our land. All these things are the tithe, okay? That we fear the Lord. Because we say we fear the Lord because that is a law. Because it's in Deuteronomy. So it is a law now. So we fear the Lord by keeping of his commandments. Go ahead, read.
Verse 24.
Uh-huh.
And if the way be too long for thee,
mm-hmm,
so that thou art not able to carry it,
uh-huh,
or if the place be too far from thee,
uh-huh,
which the Lord thy God shall choose to set his name there,
uh-huh,
when the Lord thy God hath blessed thee.
Read on.
Verse 25.
Uh-huh.
Then shalt thou turn it into money.
So now here's how it's transformed the money now. We're going to explain why is it being transformed to money. Because originally it wasn't about money. It's about the crops because you were farmers at that time, right? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Then thou shalt turn it into money.
Go ahead.
And bind up the money, mm-hmm, in thine hand.
Go ahead.
And shalt go unto the place, uh-huh, which the Lord thy God shall choose.
Which is Jerusalem now, right? Go ahead.
Verse 26.
Now here's the thing. Here's I'm going to show y'all why it said that. I'm going to give you an example. Now, you know, give me Deuteronomy 16:16. Show you something. Because this is what it's talking about. Excuse me. Tongue got tied. This is what it is talking about, right? Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 16. And I'm going to talk about it a little bit. I'm going to define it more, okay? Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 16.
Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 16.
Go ahead, brother.
Three times in a year,
mm-hmm,
shall shall all thine males appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose.
Go ahead.
In the feast of unleavened bread.
Stop. The feast of unleavened bread, brothers and sisters, is Passover. Okay? It's Passover. It's one of the same. Okay? So you came to Jerusalem. You kept the Passover, which is unleavened bread. You kept it. You went to Jerusalem. Because that's for Israelites who weren't living in Jerusalem, who were on the outskirts because you had allotment of land. Because Israel had land. You had different, you know, you had land given. There was allotted to the 12 tribes. Really 11 because the Levites didn't have land because their office was the priesthood to perform animal sacrifice, right? So three times a year, the meal, which is Feast of Unleavened Bread, which is Passover. Go ahead, read.
And in the Feast of Weeks.
The Feast of Weeks is what? Pentecost. What's the Feast of Weeks? The Feast of Weeks is what? First fruits. Feast of Weeks, right? Go ahead. Because you got 7 weeks. Plus you add the day, gives you Pentecost.
Pentecost.
Okay? Now go ahead, read.
And in the Feast of Tabernacles.
The Feast of Tabernacles. So now you recognize during those times, we were required at that time to come together. Why? Because when you got your flocks, when the way was too far for you, you couldn't take 5,000 oxen and 5,000 sheep. But you had to take it and transform it to money because the way was too far for you. So you got back to Jerusalem, go back to Deuteronomy chapter 14 in verse 26 now. You see? Because all your stuff, all your parables and stuff would have been destroyed on the trip. The animals, because you two way too long. So you had to sell it off, right? And then you get to Jerusalem, this is what you had to do. Go ahead, read.
Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 26.
Go ahead.
And thou shalt bestow that money for whatsoever thy soul lusted after.
Go ahead.
For oxen, or for sheep, or for wine,
whatever that soul desire, really. Lusted means whatever you desire. Now, I want y'all to think it means you lust. It means whatever your soul desire, which means what you're doing, you're replenishing what you sold. So, like I'm gonna give an example. If you had 5,000 sheep and 5,000 oxen, right? That said you sold it before you went to Jerusalem. What you would do once you get to Jerusalem, you would rebuy it again. So that's your desire to get back to what you sold. Don't get it confused with lust. It don't mean you're lusting after anything, okay? The Lord don't have you sinning, okay? Go ahead, read.
For oxen or for sheep or for wine.
Go ahead.
Or for strong drink.
Go ahead.
Or for whatsoever thy soul desires.
See, desires. So the lust don't necessarily mean you're lusting, like sinful. It means whatever your soul desires, because what you desire to do is replenish what you sold. So you rebuying what you sold because of the way was too long. You couldn't carry all your substance with you to Jerusalem, right? Go ahead, read.
And thou shalt eat there before the Lord thy God.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt rejoice, thou and thine household.
Go ahead.
Verse 27. Uh-huh. And the Levites.
The Levites. So now the Levite now, this is the priest. They are the priest. Now, so now their office of the priesthood is to take care of the sacrificial law. During that time, because during the time before Christ, you had to sacrifice. Okay, so the Levite, the tithers, we're going to find out who the tithers is for. Go ahead, read.
And the Levite that is within thy gate,
uh-huh.
thou shalt not forsake him.
Go ahead.
For he had no part nor inheritance with thee.
Because the Levites didn't have no land because their job was to go and perform animal sacrifice. So the other tribes, their responsibility was to take care of the Levites. Because they were of the priesthood, okay? Go ahead, read.
Verse 28.
Uh-huh.
At the end of 3 years.
Go ahead.
Thou shalt bring forth all the tithes of thine increase.
Stop right there. Now you done messed up, Christianity. How often y'all tithe? You tithe every Sunday, don't you? Read it. See, because read the time frame. After how many years? Because last I checked, these people... In these churches, they have the our people mostly, or whoever, they have them tithe every Sunday. Read what the Bible said, but this is the law of tithing. This is the law, right? Go ahead, read it again.
Verse 28.
Uh-huh.
At the end of 3 years.
The end of 3 years. Not every Sunday. Go ahead, read.
Thou shalt bring forth all the tithe of thine increase the same year.
Go ahead.
And shall lay it up within thy gates.
So now, this is the problem now. You have a problem now, y'all. Pastor, why are you getting tithed every Sunday? Because this is the law. And it's for the Levites. It's not for you. Are you a Levite? Because if you're a Levite, sir or ma'am, shouldn't you go perform a sacrifice for me? Because that was their job. Their job, they had different courses. Courses of Ibia, so forth. I'm going to just give you name a few. They had courses, right? So the Levites, their job was to perform animal sacrifice and perform judgment. So if you're getting tithe, you're supposed to be a Levite, right? Go ahead, read.
Verse 29.
Uh-huh.
And the Levite, because he had no part nor inheritance with thee, and the stranger, and the fatherless, and the widow, which are within thy gates, shall come and shall eat and be satisfied, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all the work of thine hand which thou doest.
Let me just tell y'all something. This is where they get the food bank from. You know how in various cities, they got food banks?
Yep.
They're actually mimicking what they've done for Israel, because that was for the poor, the fatherless, the widows, and the Levites. Because Levites, I'm going to say it again, they didn't have no part of land because their job was the priesthood back then. So during that time, they had all the tithe in the storehouse, the central storehouse of in Israel, okay, during that time. And you brought all your best, your best, to the Levite. That's why he said, well, a man robbed God, because during his time, y'all, Israel was getting crafty. They were taking the best of the best for themselves and not giving it to the fatherless or the Levites. That's what, go back to Malachi 3. I hope people understand what I'm talking about. Go back to Malachi 3 and 8 again.
Malachi chapter 3, verse 8.
Go ahead.
Will a man rob God?
See, that's the key. So that's the question. That's why it's asking the question, will a man rob God? You robbed God by what? Go ahead, read.
Yet ye have robbed me.
Go ahead.
But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?
Go ahead.
In tithes and offerings.
In tithes and offerings. Because during that time, y'all, the tithe and offerings were for the Levites and for the stranger and for the fatherless and for the widows. So you what you're doing, you're not giving your best increase to the storehouse. You're keeping it for yourself. You're giving, you know, you and you have to equate that to today, because let's just be honest. Are we giving our best to the Most High? And I'm not talking about just money. I'm talking about your best as far as your skill set. We're gonna deal with that in a second too. I'm talking about your skill set. And we're gonna deal with alms and show you what alms is talking about. I'm just dealing with the tithe right now. Okay. So what does it say in Malachi again?
Malachi chapter 3, verse 8.
Go ahead, brother.
Will a man rob God?
Uh-huh.
Yet ye have robbed me.
Go ahead.
But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?
Go ahead, brother.
In tithes and offerings.
Go ahead.
Verse 9. Mm-hmm. Ye are cursed with the curse.
Uh-huh.
For ye have robbed me,
uh-huh,
even this whole nation.
Because what he's saying is you curse with a curse as a nation, because we're not operating righteously. We're taking the best tithes and keeping them for ourselves and not giving our best to the storehouse. That's the food bank. And it also creates commerce, too, because once you go to Jerusalem, you give in all your tithe to the storehouse. It's a commerce for the nation. That's why you look at Cornelius. People like Cornelius. Cornelius gave much alms because he showed love for his nation. That's how you know he's an Israelite, because he gave alms to his nation. We're going to deal with alms, but because he gave his best. See, that's what we have to look at. When we do anything we do, yeah, I don't care what service we're doing. I don't care what it is. You give your best. It don't always have to be money. I'm going to show you that, okay? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 10, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse.
Go ahead.
That there may be meat in mine house.
Go ahead.
And prove me now herewith, saith the Lord.
Go ahead.
Of hosts.
Uh-huh.
If I will not open you the windows of heaven.
Go ahead.
And pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive
so
it.
So now, this is the scripture they utilize in Christianity to extort you.
They play the songs.
They play the songs. You know, they dim the lights on you. And they give different lines. The $5 line and the $100 line. And it becomes a competition now. Okay? See, that's how they get you. I'm surprised they ain't got the white gloves on.
Oh, that's old school. White gloves is old school.
Yeah. Yeah.
These days, they just came in
from
eating pork. Like,
Yeah, some pork. It's some pork grinds, right? Some pork sausage.
Exactly.
And then you can go to, we need to go, what, need to go out to eat and then eat some more abomination on top of that. Mm-hmm. So now you understand that when, what they're doing, what it's explaining to you is if you do it righteously, he said, I will, I'll open windows of heaven and pour a blessing. So it's telling you during this time, he would give you a blessing as far as bless your, let's say your profession. So we give you more of an increase when your next harvest come in. Okay, because you're being faithful and you're giving, right? Next verse.
Verse 11, and I will rebuke the devourer.
Stop right there. Now they're going to hit you now. That's how you used to hit me. Oh, the devourer, sir, is the Satan. Because what Satan's going to do to you is if you don't give your tithe, he's going to hit your pockets and devour you. I was like, excuse me? Satan's going to devour me if I don't give money? Let's find out what devours. Give me 2 Chronicles. Chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. Let's find out what is that talking about. That's why precept must be upon precept, y'all. Because if you don't understand what people are doing, they will take you for a ride. Okay, believe that, okay? Because he took me for one. I can tell you from experience. I was like, wow, I don't want Satan to take my money, you know, do this, you know, because you don't know. See what I'm saying? But once you read it for yourself and see it, yeah, go in the corral. You're right, bro. I was one of them. Going to go to the corral every Sunday. Showing up. I ain't going to sit there and lie. I was out there. You know what I'm saying? You know, so let's go right to it.
You said Malachi.
Malachi. Now, I want you to give me 2 Chronicles, 7 and 13 and 14.
7 and 13 14. All right. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13.
Go ahead.
If I shut up heaven, that there be no rain.
Go ahead.
Or if I command the locusts to devour the land.
So now, when it said devour, y'all, it means the locusts. Like the Lord, you allowed the locusts to destroy Egypt, their crops. Remember he gave those one of the plagues? The same thing with us. He said he will rebuke the devourer, which is locust. Go ahead, read. Go ahead, read.
Or if I send pestilence among my people.
Pestilence are diseases. So you can send diseases to destroy your animals. He did that. He did it. He did all that to Pharaoh and Lord's will. We're going to deal with that in Passover and explain the plagues and stuff like that. So the locust is correct. He will have the locust come and devour all your vegetation and destroy your crops because you're being disobedient. Go ahead, next verse. Was that
verse
it?
14. Mm-hmm. If my people, which are called by my name,
uh-huh.
shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
Because now what Israel were doing, they were taking the best sacrifice for themselves and not giving the sacrifice to the storehouse, which we called the central food bank at that time, for the widows, for the Levites, for the strangers, and for the fatherless, okay? That's what they weren't doing. And when you do not, and when you withholding that, you are showing hatred to your nation. You're doing that. That's why, like I said before, when Cornelius, I'm giving it as an example, when he gave his alms, it was the Lord looked upon his alms as a memorial. Because it was the same thing with Cain, with Abel. When Abel gave his sacrifices in the old world, the Lord blessed that because of his spirit behind his giving.
Right.
He didn't give begrudgingly. He gave because that was he gave out of the best out of his spirit. He gave that way. Okay, whether it was his time, whatever he gave it out of his best. Okay? If that makes sense to everybody. So if everybody understands the tithe so far. But we're not done with it. Go to Deuteronomy again. Deuteronomy chapter 26 now. Chapter 26, verse. Chapter 26, verse 12. Deuteronomy chapter 26 and verse 12. We're going to get a little bit more definitive and show some things about it. And we're going to discuss it a little bit more. Deuteronomy chapter 26 and verse 12.
All right. Deuteronomy chapter 26, verse 12.
Go ahead, brother.
When thou hast made an end of tithing, all the tithe.
Matter of fact. Jump to verse. Go to verse 11. Go to verse 11 because I want to. I don't have the word Levite. Jump to verse 11. Okay.
Deuteronomy chapter 26, verse 11.
Go ahead.
And thou shalt rejoice in every good thing which the Lord thy God had given unto thee.
Go ahead.
And unto thine house.
Uh-huh.
Thou and the Levite and the stranger that is among you.
Go ahead, brother.
Verse 12.
Uh-huh.
When thou hast made an end of tithing all the tithes of thine increase the third year.
The third year. Because remember, we talked about that before in chapter 14. To the third year, right? Because that's the time frame. Go ahead, read.
Which is the year of tithing, and has given it unto the Levites.
And to the Levites. Go ahead, read.
The stranger, the fatherless, and the widow.
Go ahead.
That they may eat within thy gates and be filled.
Go ahead, brother.
Verse 13.
Uh-huh.
Then thou shalt say before the Lord thy God,
go
I have brought away the hollow things out of my house.
Go ahead.
And also have given them unto the Levite and unto the stranger, to the fatherless, and to the widow, according to all thine commandments.
All thy what?
All thy commandments.
So now that's a commandment. That's a law. According to all thy commandments. So now you have a problem, y'all, pastor. Go ahead, read.
Which thou had commanded me. I have not transgressed thy commandments, neither have I forgotten them.
Go ahead.
Verse 14. I have not eaten thereof in my mourning.
Go ahead.
Neither have I taken away aught thereof for any unclean use.
Go ahead.
Nor given aught thereof
Go ahead.
For the dead. But I have hearkened to the voice of the Lord thy God, of the Lord my God.
Go ahead.
And have done according to all that thou hast commanded me.
This should clear up the fact, y'all, that tithing is a commandment. That was a command. That's why we tell you it's in Deuteronomy. Sure, showing y'all that tithing itself was a commandment, right? Go ahead, read.
Verse 15. Look down from thy holy habitation from heaven.
Go ahead.
And bless thy people Israel and the land which thou hast given us.
Go ahead.
As thou swearest unto our fathers.
Go ahead.
A land that floweth with milk and honey.
And so now it should make you understand, y'all, the tithe was basically, during that time, was given to the Levites, right? And the fatherless, and the widows, and the stranger, when we had the law of the stranger at the time. So at that time, you was required as Israelites to give your best to go to the storehouse, which we call today the central food bank, to help the people who were less fortunate and to support the Levites because they had no allotment of land because their job was the priesthood. From there, the book of Leviticus. Chapter 27 and verse 29. We're still dealing with, we're still in the law, aren't we? Leviticus is in the law, right? Leviticus chapter 27 and verse 29. I'm going to show you something on that.
Leviticus chapter 27 verse 29.
Go ahead.
None devoted, which shall be devoted of men, shall be redeemed, but shall surely be put to death.
Go ahead.
Verse 30. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, is the Lord.
Is the Lord. So now you understand you're dealing with crops now. You're not dealing with no money. It's dealing with crops. Because during this time, they had shekels. They had commerce back then.
Right.
So that's what I'm trying to show y'all. So I'm showing y'all how, you know, people are doing stuff and they're not reading the scriptures. Okay, go ahead, read. Go ahead.
It is holy unto the Lord.
Go ahead.
Verse 31. And if a man will at all redeem aught of the tithes, he shall add thereto the fifth part thereof.
Oh, go ahead.
Verse 32. And concerning the tithe of the herd or of the flock, even of whatsoever passeth under the rod, the tenth shall be holy unto the Lord.
So now you're dealing with the tenth. This is where we get the 10% from.
10%.
But it's dealing with crops. And it's only for who? The Levites. And for the fatherless. And for the stranger. And for the widows. See my point? Go ahead, keep reading.
Verse 33.
Go ahead.
He shall not search whether it be good or bad, neither shall he change it. And if he change it at all, then both it and the charge thereof shall be holy. It shall not be redeemed.
Go ahead.
Verse 34. These are the commandments.
That's all I want. These are the commandments. So now For you pastors out there keep saying the commandments are done away with. Why on God's green earth are you tithing? Because it is a law. That's why I want to go. I'm standing the first five books for a reason. Because the first five books is the Torah, right? The Tanakh, right? So when you look at the tithe in its entirety, what it's talking about is showing you it's dealing with the crops. They had shekels back then. They could have dealt with, if it was money, why they ain't talking about money? Because commerce was, he had commerce going on back then, right? Okay, that's why we have to get back to agriculture even today. Because when you start having your land, you have power. You can do things with land. You can cultivate the land. You see what I'm saying? Land can, you know, when you look at land, y'all, in its entirety, you can grow crops, raise animals. You can do things. You can build a nation on that. You see? Because money can only take you so far. You can generate money off of land. You see? You can generate. You can build things on land. You see? So that's why even back then, when we had our land, we were able to generate commerce through our crops, how we raised our crops, our animals, and so forth. Okay? That's how things were back then. Go to Numbers now. Numbers chapter 18 and verse 21. Then we'll get right to it. Numbers chapter 18 and verse 21. Hope people understand what we're talking about, because I want people to understand the difference, because these pastors are outrageous with this tithing stuff. And they catch people up. They don't understand what tithing is talking about. Right. Okay, and if you're going to tell me, pastor, whoever you are, that you're tithing, and you're telling me the law's done away with, then shame on you, because tithing is a law. And we in the book of the law, right?
Yeah. Numbers chapter 18, verse 21.
Go ahead, brother.
And behold, mm-hmm. I have given the children of Levi mm-hmm. all the tenth. Mm-hmm. In Israel mm-hmm. for an inheritance.
So are you? My question is, are you a Levite? That's my question, these pastors. Are you a Levite now? Because if you are a Levite now, you have to perform sacrifices for us now. You have to also perform judgments as well. If you are, because now the tenth is supposed to be for the Levite. And we're going to find out how the priesthood changed. Go ahead and read.
For their service, which they serve,
see,
even the service of the tabernacle of the congregation.
The service of the tabernacle, because that service was the tabernacle. Like I told you, they had different choruses for the different priests, right? They had responsibilities. The temple during that time, right? Go ahead, read.
Verse 22, neither must the children of Israel henceforth come nigh the tabernacle of the congregation,
uh-huh.
lest they bear sin and die.
Go ahead.
Verse 23. But the Levites shall do the service of the tabernacle of mm-hmm. the congregation,
mm-hmm.
and they shall bear their iniquity.
Uh-huh.
It shall be a statute forever
mm-hmm.
throughout your generations.
Go ahead.
That among the children of Israel, they have no inheritance.
Because they don't have the land, y'all, because the inheritance was of the Most High. Their job was to perform the service of the tabernacle, right? Go ahead and read.
Verse 24.
Uh-huh.
But the tithes of the children of Israel, which they offer as an heave offering unto the Lord,
mm-hmm.
I have given the Levites to inherit. Therefore, I have said unto them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance.
Because the Most High is taking care of the Levites through us. Okay, because our job is to support at that time the Levites. That's why I say they have no inheritance, because the inheritance was of the Most High. Right? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 25. Mm-hmm. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying,
go
verse
ahead.
26.
Mm-hmm.
Thus speak unto the Levites, mm-hmm. and say unto them,
uh-huh.
when ye take of the children of Israel the tithes which I have given you from them
mm-hmm.
for your inheritance, then ye shall offer up an heave offering of it for the Lord. Even a tenth part of the tithe.
Even a tenth part of the tithe. So the tithe at this time, y'all, I'm going to cut it short with this one for time's sake. It's showing you it was dealing with the Levitical priesthood, right? But now let's go. Now we're gonna show how the priesthood has changed. Because if that's the case, why aren't they doing sacrifices, right? From there, give me the book of Exodus, chapter 19, verse 5. Because the Lord says this to Moses to really tell Pharaoh at the time, because Pharaoh would not let us go to serve the Lord. This is what the Lord says in future tense, right? Exodus chapter 19 and verse 5.
Exodus chapter 19, verse 5.
Go ahead, brother.
Now, therefore, if you obey my voice indeed, mm-hmm. and keep my covenant,
uh-huh.
then ye shall be peculiar treasure unto me above all people.
Go ahead.
For all the earth is mine.
All the earth is mine. Go ahead, brother.
Verse 6. Mm-hmm. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests.
A kingdom of who?
Kingdom of priests.
Go ahead, read.
And in holy nation.
Go ahead.
These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
So now we're going to have to go over this one day, but I'm just going to just skim off the top. The priesthood changed after the order of Melchizedek, right? It changed. When you go to Hebrews. It changed from the Levitical priesthood, which dealt with sacrificial law. That law was nailed to the cross with Christ. Therefore, we don't have to perform animal sacrifice anymore. Now it translates to all the tribes. We are a kingdom of priests. Right? Christ is our high priest. He gave us the ultimate sacrifice. Because when we had the Levitical priesthood, the high priest at that time, he had to give a sacrifice for himself. See? Because he had to give a sacrifice because he had to give a sacrifice for himself. So now it translates, because now the Levitical priesthood has changed. It's not dealing with the sacrificial law anymore. So the tithe right now, you don't have to do the tithe anymore, because Christ nailed that ordinance to the cross. That's why we don't do sacrificial law anymore. But we still do spiritual sacrifices, because now it's showing you we're a kingdom of priests. Go to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 to clear that up too. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. So now the tithe itself, you don't have to tithe anymore. It's not about tithing anymore, because it was for the Levites. The Levitical priesthood, we're going to deal with alms now after this. Go ahead, read.
1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9.
Go ahead.
But ye are a chosen generation.
Uh-huh. A chosen generation. Mm-hmm.
A royal priesthood.
A royal priesthood now. Go ahead.
And holy nation.
Uh-huh.
A peculiar people.
Uh-huh.
That ye should show forth the praises of him who had called you out of darkness mm-hmm. into a marvelous
so
light.
So now we, all the tribes, all the Israelites, we are a kingdom of priests. Christ is our high priest now, because we don't have to worry about the law of animal sacrifice, which the tithe was for the Levitical priests. Okay? From there, Revelation chapter 1, verse 6 now. Then I want you to go to, we're going to go to Matthew about what Christ did, because Christ is going to show you something. Because what the Pharisees was doing, they were still making merchandise of the people. Okay, the same way these pastors are doing to our people today, with all this getting money and doing these different things to people, they're making merchandise of the people. Christ's going to show you something. So I'll give me the book of Revelation chapter 1 and verse 6, brother. Go ahead.
Revelation chapter 1, verse 6.
Go ahead.
And have made us kings and priests mm-hmm. unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
So now we're kings and priests now, because the priesthood, we say it changed. Now we're dealing with the priesthood is all the tribes. Christ is our head. He is our high priest. Okay? That's who he is. So now the sacrificial law, like I just explained before, was nailed to the cross. We don't have to do that anymore. Okay? So therefore, the tithe, you don't have to deal with the tithe, because the tithe was only the Levitical priest at the time, right? But let me show you what Christ did. Give me the book of Matthew chapter 21, verse 12. I'll show you something. See, and they're going to deal with, and I want you to give me the definition of alms. We'll go to that. And then Zonovan, right? Show you something. Because you notice, Christ never mentioned tithing. If you notice in the New Testament, we're going to deal with New Testament, right? New Testament. Christ or Paul never talked about tithing. We're going to show you something. We're going to show you the definition of tithing. I mean, of alms, right? But give me that. What did I tell you to get? I told you to get
Matthew 21 and 12.
That's what I wanted.
Matthew chapter 21, verse 12.
Go ahead, brother.
And Jesus went into the temple of God
uh-huh.
and cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple
mm-hmm.
and overthrew the tabernacle of the money changers
mm-hmm.
and the seats of them that sold doves.
Mm-hmm.
113.
Now, here's the thing. Let me explain this to people that don't understand why Christ did that, y'all. because what they were doing, they were making merchandise of the people. The same way these pastors do today, they don't give a doggone about the people. They care about filling their pockets. You know, what book they can sell, what they can do to this. But what are you doing for the people? Are you helping the people? You see, it's one thing to collect funds, y'all, because we do understand that, you know, we live in captivity. If you do have a building and so forth, you have to take care of expenses. You do have the ministry. You have to take care of things. We do understand it. But if you're doing things excessively, they were doing back then, they were basically taking the money, and they were doing it without a pure heart. So Christ was upset. He tossed the money changers out. You see, he's showing you the spirit behind it. Go ahead, but this is the thing. Go ahead, read.
Verse 12.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus went into the temple of God.
Go ahead.
And cast. Oh, wait. I already did.
Yeah, no, read it again.
Okay.
It
verse
again.
12.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple.
In the temple. Because you're doing it in the temple now. Go ahead, read.
And overthrew the tables of the money changers.
Uh-huh.
And the seats of them that sold doves.
Go ahead.
Verse 13. And said unto them,
uh-huh.
It is written,
mm-hmm.
My house shall be called the house of prayer,
mm-hmm.
but ye have made it a den of thieves.
Why is he saying the den of thieves? Because like I just said before, the den of thieves, because like I said, they are focusing on making a dollar off the people. They wasn't really serious about helping the people. They want to buy and sell to make money. It is the same way today with these ministries. They're going out making all this money, living a lavish lifestyle, not even helping the people. Because you have to ask yourself a question. How many of those people in the congregation are they helping? That's the thing. Okay? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 14.
Uh-huh.
And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple.
Uh-huh.
And he healed them.
He healed them. So Christ is healing them in the temple, doing the Lord's work. Go ahead, read.
Verse 15. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did.
Now listen, they saw him. I'm going to show y'all our people. And this happens to our people today. You could be doing the work of the Lord in sincerity, and people are still going to talk about you. Oh, he don't know what he's doing. He don't do this. He don't do that. You're doing the work. Who gives a damn about that? Okay, we good now? Well. Hey, listen, you can't stop this. I'm laughing. But listen, I'm going to say what I just had to say. My point I'm making is you could be doing the work of the Lord. I'm going to show you how. Read that scripture. I'm going to show you the mentality of our people. They saw the greatest man that ever walked this planet perform miracles and watch their spirit. Read it. Show yourself.
Matthew chapter 21. And verse 15. And when the chief priests
uh-huh.
and scribes
uh-huh.
saw the wonderful things that he did.
Listen, they saw the wonderful things that Christ did. Watch the spirit. Read.
And the children crying in the temple.
Go ahead.
And saying, mm-hmm. Hosanna to the Son of David.
Go ahead.
They were sore displeased.
So the scribes and Pharisees was displeased at Christ. He was doing the work. Same way our people are today. You're doing the work. They got something slick out their mouth to say. Oh, he's doing this. He's doing that. He can't do this. All praises. All praises. You're doing exactly, you playing your part. The same way they're doing back then. The greatest man that ever lived on this planet was doing works in front of them, and they still had something to say. Let that sink in for a minute, you naysayers. Let's go to the dog. Let's go to the Zion right quick. It amazes me. It really amazes me. But you're playing your part. It's beautiful.
All right, we're going to the Zonovan Compact Bible Dictionary.
Go ahead.
Source.
Yes.
And we're going to go to Alms.
Mm-hmm.
All right, it says, and oh, this is page 32, by
yes.
the way.
Mm-hmm.
This is Alms,
mm-hmm.
kind deeds arising out of compassion.
See, kind deeds, it ain't just dealing with money. It's kind, let me tell y'all something. A kind deed, y'all, let's say you have clothes. Let's say sisters may have extra dresses, extra head wraps. You may help a family who is less fortunate. That's giving your alms. Because you're showing your love for your people. Whatever skill set you may have, your profession, you may say, look, I'm going to utilize that skill set to help our people. That's a pure heart, right? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Alms, kind deeds arising out of compassion, mercy, pity of the unfortunate.
Go ahead.
Word found 14 times in Matthew, Luke, and Acts only. In later Jerusalem, the righteous of almsgiving became somewhat logistic and professional. The lame man and the gate, beautiful empathies, professional begging, in that daily he set for alms and would ask for alms, being known to the people. That's Acts chapter 3, verse 1.
Yes, sir.
Almsgiving was of two kinds. Alms of the dish, which is food, and money.
So that's why when y'all give your alms, especially to this organization, y'all, I give my alms as well. We give our alms because I'm not going to tell you to do something I don't do. So you give alms. The alms is for the ministry. Okay? We Lord's will, we get our building, whatever we do. We do that because we help our people who are unfortunate. That's our job. Okay?
Not for your jets.
Not just for your jets. Not to live a lavish lifestyle. Okay? Even the man that was sitting in the seat before me, he didn't operate like that. Okay? I would tell y'all, I've witnessed a lot of things that brother has did that he gave almost his last. So when you look at how people disrespect people, it shows me where their spirit is at. Because when you give things, you give out the goodness. And I'm not talking about just him. A brother, even with the people that was here, they did the best they could do. But the fact of the matter is, y'all, when you're giving your alms, you're giving your best, you're doing it because you love your people. That's what it's about. Now, if you're unfortunate, you might not have it like that, it's okay. The Lord may bless you someday so you can do that. Okay, go ahead, read. Go ahead.
It was this food and money received daily for distribution and alms of the chest, coins received on the Sabbath for widows.
See, so coins received on the Sabbath for the widows. So you have widows that might need some help, need helps when they don't have their husband, because their husbands was the one that was the primary source of income. Go ahead.
For widows or orphans, strangers, and the poor, practice of the New Testament church is foreshadowed in the admiration of Jesus. Give alms of such things as ye have.
And so now with Christ, now let's go to our Lord and Savior. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. We're not going to be too much longer. Okay, I just want to just bring this out, y'all, show y'all something about alms. Okay, the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6 and verse 1. You know, it's beautiful because when you see things and you see how our people operated during that time, it's no different. It's just a time frame different. That's all. The same spirits was back then, you know, and it's amazing how our Lord and Savior, he were performing miracles, doing things they saw, and they still,
That's you. You need
that's me. Okay, and they still had something crazy to really say. Here we go. Can you hear me? Okay, there we go. And they still had something to say, and it's a shame because they saw Christ do this. So you can imagine. Our people that's doing the work don't have nothing good coming. That's why I don't worry about people talk. I just let it go because I feel like, hey, you're just playing your part. It blows my part. That's why Christ says this. Give me the book of St. Matthew, chapter 6 and verse 1. Because you know something, y'all? It's amazing because we look at Christ, how Christ operated, y'all. His main focus was the nation. Okay, when Christ went to the cross, y'all, he went to the cross for the whole nation, the ones that spit on him, talked about him, beat him. What did he say? He was on that cross to have the presence of mind to say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. How many of us could have done that? That's why it's the greatest. St. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1.
Matthew chapter 6, verse 1.
Go ahead, brother.
Take heed that ye do not your alms before men.
Go ahead.
To be seen of them.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father which is in heaven.
What that means, y'all, is when you give your alms, right, you don't have to tell the world that you gave your alms. You don't have to do that.
I'm good.
Okay?
I swear.
You don't have to do that. Okay? Mine's getting like that, too. Yeah, you don't have to do that. Give me the next one. Give me another one. Okay. Hold on one second, y'all. Hold on.
That might work. Huh? Oh, man, that's super dead. Here, try this one.
Try that one? Okay. Yeah. Hold on one second.
Hold on, bro. I'm turning red, too.
Are we good now? Oh, yeah, we good now. Good. There we go. All right, like I was saying before, so now let's go right. So what that was showing you is Christ is saying, don't do your alms before men. Okay? Don't do it before men. Do it in secret. He's going to explain it. Go ahead, read.
Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. Take heed that ye do not your alms before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. You want to go to two?
Huh?
Want to go to two?
Yeah.
Verse 2. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward.
Okay. So verily I say unto you,
just have to.
What do we have? Hey, look. this is something. But it's all good, though. Go ahead, give it to me. Give it to me. It's still red. It's still red, though. I think I'll be all right, though. Let me just keep on going, man. All right, don't worry about it. Yeah. So anyway, I'm still going
to say it. But anyway, get back to what I was saying. And shut off again.
But anyway, go back. Matthew chapter 6. What verse was you on?
That was 2 I just read.
Okay, that was 2. All right. So chapter 2, so verse 2 says, it says, therefore, because here's the thing. What he's saying is, do not just give your alms for everyone to see. Okay, like they do in these churches. They play that. I told you, they give the $100 line, the $50 line, all that nonsense. Don't let everyone know that you gave your alms. You don't have to do that. That's all the Lord is saying. Okay? You don't have to do that. Well, you got that? I could try that. Hold on. Is it on? Hello? Shalom. Got it? Is it on? Yeah, so what Christ is saying, you don't have to sound an alarm. Okay? You don't have to show the world, look at me, I gave alms. It's not about that. Because, read it again. Read that next verse.
Matthew chapter 6, verse 2. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men.
Because now you're being seen of men. So now you're trying to show everybody, look at me, I gave my alms, I did this, I did that.
Verily I say unto you, that they have their reward.
They have their reward. Go ahead.
Verse 3. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth.
So go ahead, read.
Verse 4. That thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly.
So now what that's basically saying, y'all, is you don't have to give your alms, and it's, and like I said, your time, your skill set, whatever you may have to offer the nation to help our people
Ecclesiastes chapter 40 and verse 24. I'm going to stick with this right now.
I might have to switch with Raphael.
It's good?
Whenever okay, you read. No. All right. Ecclesiastes chapter 40, verse 24. Brethren, and you said 24?
Yeah, 24.
Okay. Brethren, and help are against time of trouble, but alms shall deliver more than them both.
Okay, I'm okay. Give it back to me with this one. We'll work on that later. What did he say again? Read it again. I'm sorry.
Ecclesiastes chapter. Ecclesiastes chapter 40, verse 24. Brethren, and help are against time of trouble, but alms shall deliver more than them both.
So alms should deliver you both, because once you give your alms out of your spirit, the Lord is going to bless you because you're doing out of the goodness of your heart. Go ahead, read.
Verse 25. Gold and silver make the foot stand sure, but counsel is esteemed above them both.
Above them both. Go ahead.
Verse 26. Riches and strength lift up the heart, but the fear of the Lord is above them both. There is no want in the fear of the Lord.
Because the fear of the Lord is keeping of the commandments, because you know that you're doing this out of the goodness of your heart. You're doing it because you truly do believe that this is going to help your people. Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
And it needed not to seek help.
Go ahead.
Verse 27. The fear of the Lord is a fruitful garden, and covereth him above all glory.
It covereth him above of all glory, because it's showing you there that once you give your alms, like I said before, whether it could be your money, or whether it could be your time or your skill set, whatever you can do to help your people, that's what the Most High is looking at. Okay, from there, stand Sirach, chapter 29 and verse 9. Sirach Ecclesiasticus. Chapter 29 and verse 9. Okay, I'm gonna deal with this. It's good now? Okay. You good? Yeah. Go ahead. You good, Ben? Hey, go with this, Ben. Hey, let. Hey, go ahead, Ben. Go ahead. Hold on, y'all. It's all good.
Ecclesiastes chapter 29, verse 9.
Go ahead.
Help the poor for the commandment's sake.
So help the poor for the commandment's sake. Go ahead, read.
And turn him not away because of his poverty.
Go ahead.
Verse 10. Loose thy money for thy brother and thy friend, and let it not rust under a stone.
What that means, y'all, is sometimes you might suffer a loss financially for your brother. I'm using an example. Let's say a brother needed something. He needed my help, right? And I gave him something, or sister, I gave them something, and they can't pay it back because they're in dire straits, whatever. When it says lose that money for that friend, it's saying, okay, well, we understand that person aren't able to pay it back. I'm not going to go crazy over it and say, you know what, I'm going to hound you about it. What that is basically saying is lose your money for your friend. Give the example. Okay, now I'm not saying you should get your money back. If that person promised you to get your money back, that's a different story. But if you know a person's in dire straits, they can't really afford it, you do the best you can to help your people. Okay, that's all it's about. So when you lose your money for your friend, for your brother, you showing truth, that true love for your brother. So you know what, sister? They may need some help, okay? That doesn't mean you can utilize the school or the people for an ATM machine. That ain't what that means, okay? Are you good? Go ahead. Next verse.
What are we at, 10?
No, we're at 11. We're at 11.
Verse 11. Lay up thy treasure according to the commandments of the Most High.
Go ahead.
And it shall bring thee more profit than gold.
It should bring more profit than gold, because the Lord can also bless you with longer life, with health. Okay, like I said, let me tell y'all something. Blessings ain't always about money. It's about your peace of mind. It's about, the Lord can bless you all kinds of ways. But like I said before, you utilize your skill set to help your people. Go ahead and read. Next verse.
Verse 12.
Uh-huh.
Shut up alms in thy storehouse, and it shall deliver thee from all affliction.
You see that? Shut up alms in thy storehouses, and it shall deliver thee from all affliction. Go ahead, read.
Verse 13. It shall fight for thee against thine enemies. Mm-hmm. Be better than a mighty shield and strong spear.
So now, when you think about it, when you give your alms, it also can help you in your time of need. You may fall on hard times. You know what I'm saying? Some things may happen to you, you know, that you may need someone to help you. So it ain't always, you may not always be on top of your game. You may, something can happen to you. Let's say your health can decline. You may need someone to help you out. You know, it happens, okay? It's life, okay? Jump to verse 20.
Ecclesiastes chapter 29, verse 20.
Go ahead.
Help thy neighbor according to thy power.
Go ahead.
And beware that thou thyself fall not into the same.
When it says help thy neighbor according to thy power, y'all, it means help according to what you can afford. You may not be able to give that brother or sister a lot of, you know, whatever, because you may fall into the same situation. What it said, you have to give your last, okay, to help someone. You know, even when you give them your alms, you give according to how you're blessed. All you can do is give what you can give. You see, and we're going to explain that more in Tobit to show you what that means, because sometimes you may not have that, like, have it like that, okay, or consistently, you know, but the Most High, it may bless you enough to help, to do the best you can. You see, now from there, go to the book of Tobit. We almost done Tobit chapter 4 and verse 7. Tobit chapter 4 and verse 7. We almost done, y'all. Okay, I can get the feasting, okay?
Tobit chapter 4 verse 7.
Go ahead.
Give alms of thy substance.
Go ahead.
And when thou givest alms, let not thine eye be envious.
Go ahead.
Neither turn thy face from any poor.
Mm-hmm.
And the face of God shall not be turned away from thee.
So it's showing you can't turn your face from the poor, because you may fall into that situation. Okay? Go ahead, next verse.
Verse 8, if thou hast abundance, give alms accordingly.
So if you have abundance, give accordingly. If you don't have that, you can't give abundantly if you don't have a lot of money to give.
Can't give what you don't have.
You can't give what you don't have. And then you may have your bills. You got to pay your bills. You can't just say, you know what, I'm going to forsake my bills. And then we would never tell someone to do that. But you have that's between you and the Most High. Okay, we will, you know. Because like I said, the last, so you don't want to fall into that same situation that your brother was in, okay, or your sister was in. Go ahead, read.
If thou have but a little,
uh-huh,
be not afraid to give according to that little.
Give according to that little. So all you can give, if that's all you can give, is a certain amount of money or whatever you can give, give according to what you're blessed with. The Lord sees your spirit. He tries the reins, okay? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 9. For thou layest up a good treasure for thyself against the day of necessity.
Because you may need something one day. So you, if that person don't want to give alms and stuff like that, you talk a real good game and you don't want to do that, that's between you and the Most High. The Most High sees it. We're not gonna put no guilt trip on nobody that don't want to give. That's up to you and the Most High. Okay, go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 10. Because that alms do deliver from death.
What?
But because that alms do deliver from death.
Uh-huh.
And suffer not to come into darkness.
So alms deliver from death. That's what the scriptures say. Because you're doing it with a pure heart. You're not doing it begrudgingly. It's a difference between that, okay? Go ahead, read. Go ahead.
Verse 11. Mm-hmm. For alms is a good gift unto all that give it in the sight of the Most High.
Did you read that verse one more time?
Tobit chapter 4, verse 11.
Go ahead, brother.
For alms is a good gift unto all that give it in the sight of the Most High.
It's a good gift. Unto all they give it in the sight of the Most High. That's the clear point. That's who you want to please. It's the Most High. You know what you can and cannot do. We will not extort money from people. We don't operate like that. Okay? We love our people enough to know that, listen, we know people are in need. We try to do the best we can to, even with the Passover, we even had to try to work the Passover so people can be able to afford it. The best way we know how, because we understand people are struggling and this economy is not kind, okay? We know that. So, but we still have to pay things. You know, you still have to pay. You still got to, you know, we live in a society where everything is dictated by money. So we're looking at this in this respect, that we do this because of the love of the people, okay? Last scripture, give me the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 9 and verse 7 to finish up. And then everybody, and I'm going to touch a little bit on the new moon right quick. I want to touch the new moon real quick, and then we're going to be done. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 7. Hopefully people understand the difference, how things work with the alms.
2 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 7.
Go ahead.
Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, mm-hmm. so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity. For God loveth a cheerful giver.
Because, you know, a cheerful giver, the Lord loves that. If you're a person that loves to give, to help people, that's a skill set, y'all. I mean, you might not be as well versed in scriptures as other people, but you know how to give and how to help your people. The Lord still sees the hospitality, whatever you can provide to help your people. Because you're doing it with a pure heart. You're not doing it begrudgingly. You're not doing, oh, I got to go ahead and get him more money. Here we go again. It's more money.
You could say that to the church, though.
To
the Christian church.
Yeah, they're giving it, they mess you over with the tithes and stuff like that.
I passed the plate three times.
You know, and it's a shame, y'all, that they do all people like that. But hopefully y'all got something out today's class about that, about tithing and alms. Hopefully you understand the difference in how we operate with that, okay, within the confines of the scriptures. We're going to the new moon now. Give me the book of, give me the book of Psalms chapter 81, verse 3. 81 verse 3. When was the new moon implemented? When was it ordained? Let's go to the book of Psalms, chapter 81 and verse 3.
Psalms, chapter 81, verse 3.
Go ahead, brother.
Blow up the trumpet in the new moon.
That's an ordinance. You blow the trumpet. Some of y'all just did it earlier. All praises. You blow the trumpet in the new moon. That's an ordinance within the law. Go ahead, read.
In the time appointed.
The time appointed. We do know at the beginning of every month is the time appointed. We do know it was appointed during the time of Joseph. Go ahead, read.
On our solemn feast day.
Go ahead.
Verse 4. For this was a statute for Israel and a law of the God of Jacob.
This was a statute for Israel. The God of Jacob is our statute, which is a law within the law of the new moon. Okay. From there, go to the book of Amos, chapter 8 and verse 5. Amos chapter 8 and verse 5. Okay. Amos chapter 8 to prove a point.
Amos chapter 8 verse 5.
Go ahead, read.
Saying, when will the new moon be gone?
That's what spirit you don't want to have. You don't want to be like, oh, I can't wait till the new moon's over so I can go out here and buy and sell. That's what Israel were doing back then. Okay, go ahead, read.
That we may sell corn. Mm-hmm. The Sabbath, that we may set forth wheat, mm-hmm. making the ephah small mm-hmm. and the shekel great. And falsifying the balances by deceit.
And this is how you have to understand, y'all, that keep in mind during this time, it's showing you also that the new moon is a Sabbath. That's what that scripture proves. It is a Sabbath, okay? From there, give me the book of Sirach or Ecclesiasticus, chapter 43, verse 6, to clear up the new moon, okay? Ecclesiasticus and the Apocrypha. Chapter 43 and verse 6. Okay.
Ecclesiasticus chapter 43 and verse 6.
Go ahead.
He made the moon also to serve in her season.
Now the new moon is in her seasons. That's how we're able to calculate the feast days. Because like we have the Passover coming up. Well, the first new moon of the year is going to be on March 21st, which is the first day of spring. In the ear of corn. So it's the first new moon of the spring, which is the first of the new year. Go ahead, read.
He made the moon also to serve in her season.
Go ahead.
For a declaration of times.
Go ahead.
And a sign of the world.
The sign of the world. Go ahead, read.
Verse 7. Mm-hmm. From the moon mm-hmm. is the sign of feast.
Sign of feast. Like I just explained before, that's how we calculate the feast days through the new moons. Go ahead, read.
A light that decreaseth in her perfection.
A light that decreaseth for, so when it's perfect, when it's full, it decreases, right? Go ahead, read.
Verse 8, mm-hmm. The month is called after her name.
The month is called, go ahead, read.
Increasing wonderfully.
So now, once we have the dark moon, once it completes its cycle, it renews itself, now it's going to increase now to revolve and complete another cycle. Because the new moon is when you should not see it, because it's renewing itself, okay? It can't renew itself if it's perfected. That's not new. It doesn't renew it. It renews itself when it is completed a cycle. Go ahead, read.
increasing wonderfully in her changing, mm-hmm. being an instrument of the armies above, mm-hmm. shining in the firmament of heaven.
Shining in the firmament of heaven. Let's find out if we're gonna keep the new moons in the kingdom.
Kingdom.
Give me the book of Isaiah, chapter 66, and verse 23. Let's find out if we're gonna keep this glorious ordinance in the kingdom. That's why it's important to know, y'all, why you are doing what you are doing. To know why, okay, that's what you want to know. So the book of Isaiah, chapter 66 and verse 23.
Isaiah chapter 66, verse 23.
Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another.
From one new moon to another. Go ahead, read.
And from one Sabbath to another.
Go ahead.
Shall all flesh come to worship before me.
Matter of fact, said the Lord. Go to verse 22. I'm sorry. Start verse 22. That's what I wanted. Then jump down. So we're going to know where this is going to be at. Go ahead, read.
Isaiah chapter 66, verse 22.
Go ahead.
For as the new heavens.
That's what I wanted. For the new heavens. Now this is dealing with the kingdom, right? Go ahead, read.
And the new earth.
And the new earth. Go ahead, read.
Which I will make.
Which he will make. Go ahead, read.
Shall remain before me.
Go ahead.
Saith the Lord.
Go ahead.
So shall your seed and your name remain.
Go ahead.
Verse 23. Uh-huh. And it shall come to pass uh-huh. that from one new moon
so
to another.
Now it clears up so with the kingdom. From one new moon to another, go ahead, read.
And from one Sabbath to another,
go ahead.
Shall all flesh come to worship before me, mm-hmm. saith the Lord.
Saith the Lord. Saith the Lord. So now we do understand, y'all, Lord's will. We should be keeping the new moons in the kingdom. From there, finish up. Nehemiah chapter 8 and verse 10. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10, y'all. I want everyone to enjoy these feast days, y'all, because all we got is Israel. Nehemiah chapter 8 and verse 10, brother.
Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10.
Go ahead.
Then he said unto them, mm-hmm. Go your way.
Go your way. Go ahead.
Eat the fat.
Eat the best. When it says eat the fat, means eat the best. Go ahead, read.
And drink the sweet.
And drink the sweet. Go ahead, read.
And send portions unto them mm-hmm. for whom nothing is prepared.
Go ahead.
For this day is holy unto our Lord.
Go ahead.
Neither be ye sorry.
Don't be sorry. Go ahead.
For the joy of the Lord is your strength.
The joy of the Lord is your strength. Because when you're around your fellow Israelite brothers and sisters, they have the same mind, the same judgment. It's a beautiful thing, okay? Beautiful thing. First Peter chapter 2 and verse 21, y'all, to finish up on today's topic. I pray everyone got some out of today's class. Like I said, I hope y'all have a great, beautiful time, beautiful week, okay?
First Peter chapter 2, verse 21.
Go ahead, read.
For even hereunto were ye called.
You were called in this marvelous truth to do the work of the Most High. Go ahead, read.
Because Christ also suffered for us.
Because Christ suffered for us. Go ahead, read.
Leaving us an example.
Because Christ is our example. Go ahead, read.
That ye shall follow his steps.
Go ahead, brother.
Verse 22. Mm-hmm. Who did no sin.
Go ahead.
Neither was guile found in his mouth.
He wasn't deceitful. Go ahead, read.
Verse 23. Mm-hmm. Who, when he was reviled, mm-hmm. reviled not again.
When he spoke evil of Christ, Christ said, thou sayest, and kept it moving. Go ahead, read.
When he suffered, mm-hmm. he threatened not.
Go ahead.
But committed himself to him that judged righteously.
He committed himself to the Most High, the Father of spirits, the Most High himself, the omnipotent one. The book of Acts, chapter 5 and verse 29.
The book of Acts, mm-hmm. chapter 5, verse 29.
Go ahead, brother.
Then Peter mm-hmm. and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men.
We ought to obey God rather than men, y'all. I just pray that everyone got some out tonight's class. We're also going to give the Most High Christ all the praise and glory for allowing us the privilege to teach this word. I pray y'all got some out today's class. Also, I want to give a shout out to the elders, the bishops, the priests, the deacons, the sisters out there doing the work. Keep up the good work, y'all, because we got Israel. Also, send your alms. We definitely need the alms to help build the nation, to help our people to build. Also, get your Passover feast ready. We do know that's coming up pretty soon. Make sure you get all the leaven out. Y'all get the leaven out of your house. Try start getting it out. Because before you know it, April 4th will be here, y'all. So it'll come up on you quick. So let's take care of all that stuff right now. Also, they say let's join the force. Join the force. Come and build this great nation. Listen, the laborers are few, but the harvest is great. We have a lot of work to do, y'all. Our people need to wake up. We have to be that great example. All praise to the Most High Christ, peace and bless. Let prayer by a glorious week. Be peaceful and take your time, y'all, because we know Satan and that death angel is out there. So, I pray for everybody. Y'all stay strong. Stay focused. Because Satan is trying his best to derail you. Okay? Take your crown. Like I said before, Shalom, most on Christ bless. Happy New Moon to the 12 tribes of Israel. With that, we're going to say
Shalom.
Chapter 11, verse 1. I say this, has God cast away his people,
you so-called blacks and Hispanics, the Israelites, have God cast away his people?
Read, God forbid.
Meaning no, God has not cast away the Israelites. Read.
For I also am an Israelite.
Paul said, I also am an Israelite. That's the New Testament. Read.
Of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin.
Of God.